Okay, so today I want to talk about dynamics in two complex dimensions and talk about the equidistribution problem that we addressed yesterday. So the setting will be that of a holomorphic mapping on P2, meaning that there is no indeterminacy. The mapping is holomorphic everywhere, and the degree is D, larger than 2. So yesterday we saw that if you take a point in P1 and you try to look at pre-images of this point, they tend to equidistribute, right? Now a point in P1 has two analogs in dimension 2. Either you can see it as a subset of dimension 0, or you can see it as a subset of codimension 1, okay? So here we have two equidistribution problems, which are different. So you have equidistribution problem for points. So you take a point Z in P2 and look at pre-images of Z. And look at pre-images of Z under Fn. So actually this set has D to the power 2n points. So one simple way of proving this is that Z is, say, the intersection of two lines through Z. So when you take pullbacks of this situation, so that's L prime, the pre-image of L, so that's the pre-image of L, it is an algebraic curve, which is generically smooth, of degree D to the N. So it's a curve of degree D to the N, and the pre-image of, and the pre-image of L prime also. Okay, so by Bézout theorem, you get D to the 2N points, okay? So by Bézout theorem, get D to the power 2N points with multiplicity. Okay, so if you want to make equidistribution, you take the normalized Dirac measure on this, Fn of y equals z, and put a direct mass at each of these points. And the question is this equidistributing to something? Okay? In the sense of probability measures. And now you can look also, so actually it will be a consequence, this equidistribution here, of the equidistribution problem for subvarieties. So for subvarieties, so let's say you start with a line. So as we've just said, the pre-image of this line is a subvariety of degree D to the power N. By the way, a proof of that is simple. The line has a homogeneous equation of the form AZ plus BW plus CT is equal to 0. Okay, and if you write in homogeneous coordinates f as, let's say, pqr, then f to the n is pn, p sub n, q sub n, r sub n, with these are homogeneous polynomials of degree d to the n, and so the equation of the pre-image of L is just apn plus bqn plus cqn equals 0. So it's a curve. You see the equation of a curve of the degree d to the n. Rn, yes, excuse me. Rn, here. Okay? So now, there's something to understand is, so we would like to prove that this kind of sequences of subvarieties or submanifolds equidistribute to something. But now, you cannot just take, direct masses. You need to have a formalism to what it means for a sequence of curves to equidistribute. Okay, and the right formalism is that of positive closed current. So I will spend some time explaining to you what a positive closed current is. So that's a basic tool here. It's positive closed currents. Okay, so what is a current? So we will work in dimension two. So my currents will be 1-1 currents. So I will consider, let's work locally for the moment. So we take an open set, so work locally. We take an open set in C2. Let's say we have coordinates Z1 and Z2. Okay? What is a 1-1 current on omega? It's just something, an object, which takes a 1-1 form, which take a 1-1 form, and so T takes a 1-1 form and gives you a number. So it's an element of the dual of 1-1 forms. So there are two basic examples. So 1-1, say, smooth test form. So it's smooth with, say, compact support in omega. So it takes a smooth form and gives you a number. Like, so think about distributions, right? Or think about measures in the plane. A measure takes a function and gives you a number. So here you act on forms, 1-1 forms. So you have two basic examples of currents. So I have two basic examples. First example is a 1-1 form itself. So if psi is a 1-1 form, or even a 2 form, well, you can do the following. You can take phi and map it to the integral of phi wedge psi. So now this is a form of maximal dimension, 2-2 form, and you can integrate a 2-2 form on omega. So this is the current associated, let's say it's T psi. It's the current associated to psi, exactly as when you have a locally integrable function, there's a distribution associated to it. You can integrate. So every function gives rise to a distribution by integration, and every form gives rise to a current by integration. And the second basic example is if you take a submanifold of dimension 2, let's say a complex submanifold, So here it's a curve. You can integrate. So I have the integration current to a form, associate the integral of the form on this manifold. Okay? Again, you get a number. So this is the current of integration associated to this submanifold. So now there are two other words, positive and closed. So closed is easy. So closed means that the current has no boundary, meaning that if you integrate T against a boundary, then you get zero. Okay? So that's the definition of closed. So here it corresponds, so by the Stokes theorem, it corresponds to the case where V has no boundary. So this is closed when V has no boundary. This is just the Stokes theorem. So what does positive means? So this theory of positive currents was invented by Lelong. So in French, positive means non-negative. So perhaps the proper translation would be non-negative currents, but I mean, now everybody says positive, but right English word should be done negative. So what is this positivity here? So there's an important fact that complex manifold carry a certain positive structure. What does it mean? Think about the plane. In one dimension, if you take an object of the form A of Z, dz dz bar, let me put an I here by tradition, where A is a real function with positive values, and you change coordinates, what happens? If you change coordinates, like zeta is f, z is f of zeta. When you change coordinate, what you get is a of f of zeta modulus square of the modulus of derivative of f times d zeta bar. So still I here. And you see that the positivity of this term is invariant on the holomorphic change of coordinates. Okay, so this is intrinsic. The positivity of this function here is intrinsic. And the same phenomenon happens in higher dimension. The definition of positivity is slightly more complicated. I don't want to state the... I will give the definition, okay? So the positivity that... So here it's positivity for 1-1 forms in one complex variable, okay? And you have the same... There is a corresponding notion of positivity for every bidegree. Okay? So here, in two dimensions, so in C2, I need perhaps more space here. So in C2, a 1-1 form, if you look at an object of the form sum, so 1-1 form is a sum of aij, there's a square root of minus 1 somewhere, dzi dzj bar, from ij equals 1 to 2, okay, corresponding to a certain Hermitian matrix, to a certain matrix, A11, A12, A21, A22. Okay? And this is positive if this matrix is Hermitian and non-negative. Okay? And this notion, simple computation, is invariant on the holomorphic change of coordinates. So this is an intrinsic notion. Okay? Now we say that the current is positive. T is a positive current. If it gives a positive value to every positive form. If whenever phi is a positive 1-1 form, the value of T against phi is a positive number, non-negative number. Okay, so it's the same as a positive measure, right? Okay, so in this respect, of course, the integration current associated to a positive form is a positive current. And more importantly, here I don't need complex to integrate a two form. So if any two-dimensional submanifold gives rise to a certain current of dimension 2. And now this current is positive if and only if the submanifold is complex. Okay, so positive currents, positive closed currents, are a generalization of a complex submanifold without boundary. Okay, so this is positive. And the reason why this current is positive is just that positivity is invariant under change of coordinates. So if I take local coordinate, I mean, there's a small proof to be done here. Okay, what do I want to say about positive currents? So you should think as a positive current as a differential form with measure coefficients. So you put measure here, you put measures here, and you have a matrix of measures, and this matrix should be Hermitian non-negative in a sense. Okay, so positive currents, so as we said, they generalize complex submanifolds. So there's another example which is important from the point of view of complex dynamics, which is this one. Let me just put it here.
Just a historical question. Who was the person who introduced currents?
So the currents were introduced by Dujardin to give a geometric realization of Poincaré duality. Because you have something which interpolates between homology and cohomology. You have subvarieties, submanifolds, and differential form at the same time. Okay, so it's a geometric way of seeing Poincaré duality. And this notion of positivity was introduced by Lelong, Pierre Lelong, in the 50s. So just after Dujardin, I guess. Just one word here. One important result by Lelong is that you can integrate against a submanifold, but you can also integrate against a subvariety. So you can take here T a subvariety, possibility with singularities, and only integrate on the regular part of the subvariety. And this gives you, you can integrate, the volume is locally finite, and the current is closed. If the subvariety has no boundary, these singularities will not create boundary because they are too small. So you can actually integrate with respect to any complex subvariety. So another example here, assume that you have a certain family, a measurable family of subvarieties with a positive measure on it, mu, a measure on the parameter space. Okay, positive measure. Then you can form a current, which is the integral of the integration current over your family of varieties. Okay, so this family of varieties can be a lamination or maybe something more complicated. So you can just integrate this integration current, meaning that if you take a test form, you integrate on against V alpha, and then you integrate against alpha. This defines a positive closed current, and these kinds of currents are very important in holomorphic dynamics. Okay, what is important? So let me now go to P2. So here I was discussing locally. On P2, let me remind that you have this basic fact that you have a Fubini's 2D metric. You have the Fubini's 2D metric, which is associated to the Fubini's 2D Keller form. So there's a certain two form, which has the remarkable property that if V is a curve, an algebraic curve, so every complex submanifold of P2 is algebraic of degree D. Then the area or the volume of V with respect to the Fubini's 2D metric is equal to the integral of this Keller form on the curve, okay? And this is really remarkable because this is only a cohomological quantity. This curve, this Keller form by definition is closed. So this quantity is just a cohomological quantity. And actually it's just an integer. It is the degree of the curve, okay? And now if you take a positive closed current, on P2, you can define its mass. It is exactly this number, T against the Fubini's 2D form. So it's the analog of the volume for a subvariety. And now the point is that the set, so the important point, so exactly as the set of probability measures on a compact space is compact, the set of currents of bounded mass is compact for the weak topology. So that's a fact, easy fact. The set of currents on P2, actually it's a local fact, but let me state it globally, with mass 1, less than 1, is compact for the weak topology. So now if I have a sequence of varieties Vn of degree d to the dn, well, I can consider the sequence of current normalized integration currents on Vn, and I get a sequence of currents of mass 1. So this leaf is in compact set, and it makes sense to wonder whether this converges to something. So it's a relatively compact subset. Okay, so now I can make sense of the equidistribution problem for subvarieties. So now the equidistribution problem for subvariety, problem for subvarieties in my dynamical setting is the following. Let V be a curve in P2. And the question is, does the sequence of currents 1 over dn times the degree of V times integration on the pullback of V converge to something in the sense of currents? And actually, it's not difficult to deal with this kind of question because, as I said in the last talk, a measure in the plane is just the Laplacian of a function. So if you want to deal with measure, you just have to deal with function, which is easier. Here is the same. So 1-1 positive closed fact, a positive closed 1-1 current on, let's say, so it's a local statement. So exactly as on P1, you have no global potential because there are no subharmonic functions, you have the same problem here. So you have to define potentials locally. On a ball, say, in C2, has a potential, which is a function, meaning that this current T is the DDC. So DDC is another notation for I over pi DD bar of a certain function. So if you take a function, so I will do the computer. If you take a function and you take two exterior derivatives, you get an object which is of a kind 2-form. So it's rather a current. And so dealing with T is the same as dealing with the potential U, which is a plurisubharmonic function. Okay, so the definition of DDCU, just if you want to integrate DDCU against a test function, by definition, so it's exactly as with distribution. This is U against DDC phi. And now this is just, so that's a test function. Okay? And this is just a classical integral. Because DDC phi is a function, is a form of maximal degree. Okay? So you deal exactly as derivating distributions. Okay, so working with currents is easy. You just have to work with potentials. And so actually the equidistribution problem for subvarieties, at least for generic subvarieties, is not very difficult. Because the proof is exactly the same as the one as I gave yesterday for measures on P1. So let me state a theorem. So there are many authors. Let me say it after that. So if L is a generic line on P2, then a sequence of currents, 1 over d to the n preimage of L, converges to a certain current, which is, of course, independent of the choices, to a certain current T, which is called the green current. Okay? Another result here is that the support of the green current is exactly the Julia set. Okay? So let me first comment on the first item. So what does generic means here? So the difficulty of the theorem depends on what you put in the word generic. Okay? So the set of lines on P2 is a P2. So if you want to prove this for almost every line, this is not very difficult. So for almost every line, for instance, so if generic means almost everywhere, this was done by Fornes and Siboney at the very beginning of higher dimensional holomorphic dynamics. Now, if you want to prove for every line outside a certain algebraic exceptional set of lines, algebraic exceptional set, then it becomes much more difficult. So it's a very delicate problem to understand exactly what is the exceptional set of lines for which this convergence does not hold. And in P2, this problem has been solved completely. In higher dimensions, I don't think we have a complete answer to this problem. So in this case, it's a theorem by Favre and Johnson, which relies on very elaborate algebraic techniques. Okay, they have to do a very delicate algebraic analysis of the singularities that can happen. It's a delicate theorem. Okay? But if you start with, say, a smooth positive form, and the proof of this theorem is exactly identical to the one I did yesterday. Okay, so we have this interesting fact that the support of this current is exactly the Julia set. So it says something about the Julia set. So it says that the Julia set is an object which has the type of a curve, okay, which has a cohomology class in a sense. So this has some consequences on the Julia set. Consequences on the Julia set. So the Julia set is an object which has a, which is a codimension one object. So it's a complex codimension one object. Complex codimension one object. So for instance, it must intersect any algebraic curve. Okay, so you cannot imagine that on P2 you have a, it cannot be contained in a ball in P2, for instance, because it must intersect every algebraic curve. Also, you know from this theorem, so the potential of T, the potential of T is Hölder continuous, again, because it's the limit of a geometrically convergent series. So it says that the Hausdorff dimension of the Julia set is bigger than 2. So 2 is automatic because you have a codimension 1 object, okay? But it's bigger than 2 plus alpha for some positive alpha. Okay, another property is that the Julia set is connected, always. Because the support of a current, I mean, a codimension 1 object in P2 is always connected because two lines must intersect. Okay, so it gives you some information about what the Julia set looks like. Okay, what about equidistribution for points? So actually, equidistribution for points is more complicated. So let me come back to the picture. I said before that the point, you can view it as the intersection of two lines. Okay, so the preimage of a point is the intersection of two algebraic varieties of large degree. And now we know, so L, L prime. So we know that the preimage of N converges in the sense of current to the current T, and also preimage of L prime. And same for L prime. So one would be tempted to try to intersect these objects. So we are looking at the intersection of these two objects. And the good news is that one can intersect currents. So this converges to the self-intersection of the current T. So there's a way of making sense of it. So I should point out that this intersection is a complicated object. Well, it's not obvious to define. And the reason is that you want, so imagine you are dealing with differential forms. You have to multiply the coefficients, okay? And you don't know how to multiply measures or distribution. There's no sensible way of multiplying measures, okay? So you have to understand what this object is. And there's a little bit of analysis to do. Perhaps I don't have the time to explain exactly. But the construction of this wedge product is not obvious, but it's classical in complex dynamics. So it's something which goes back to the 70s, and this construction was done by Bedford and Taylor. Bedford and Taylor in the 70s. And it has to do with the potentials. So it works well when the currents have continuous potentials, which is exactly the case here. One difficulty is that this wedge product is not continuous with respect to the weak topology. So actually, the implication here is false. Okay, you cannot deduce from this convergence, you cannot deduce this from that. Okay, you need to work, there's some analysis to do here. It's not obvious, but at the end of the day, you're able to prove something like that. So let me state a precise result. So actually, the way you prove it is not exactly this one. So you cannot just start with two lines, and if you try to prove this head-on, you will never manage to do it. Okay, so you first need to start with smooth forms, use the convergence. So let me perhaps write down something precise. How? So what you do is, So what is true is that if, let's say, phi is a smooth closed 1-1 form, then, as I said, 1 of mass 1, what about the n pullback of phi, as we said, converges to the green current. So this is the smooth version of the equidistribution theorem in codimension 1. And now it is true that you can wedge this. 1 over dn, fn star of phi wedged with itself. So this is exactly the same as the pullback of the positive measure phi square. So phi square is a positive measure now. Okay? And the pullback of phi, the sequence of pullbacks of phi square converges to t square. So this is correct. This follows from the definition of the wedge product here, because you have the key fact is uniform convergence of the potential. Uniform convergence of the potential. So we face exactly the same difficulty as yesterday. Yesterday, I told you that the potential of a Dirac mass is unbounded. Okay, it's not a continuous function, it causes problems. Here, the potential is smooth, and the sequence of potentials converges uniformly. And so if you look at the definition of QHC, which I did not give, actually, this is true. So what we get from this is that corollary of that, if you start with a smooth measure, you have convergence. So if you, so the corollary of that, if, let's say, nu is a smooth probability measure on P2, then the sequence of pullbacks converges to the self-intersection of T, which by definition is the equilibrium measure. That's the definition, equilibrium measure. Okay, so this is this argument. And then what you have to prove is an equidistribution theorem. And then you prove an equidistribution theorem. And the equidistribution theorem is that for generic x, y in P2, if you look at the pullbacks of the corresponding Dirac masses, this converges to zero. Okay? So if you put these two results together, then you get that for a generic corollary, for generic x, the sequence of pullbacks of, there's a 2 here, of the Dirac mass converge to mu. Okay, this is because smooth measure is just an integral of Dirac mass. Okay, and again, the difficulty of this theorem depends on what you call generic. So again, if you want to prove this for almost every point, this is not very complicated. So if generic means, if this means almost every with respect to the Lebesgue measure, it's not so difficult. You need some complex analysis. It was done by, I think, first by Rusakovsky and Schiffman. And so there's a whole bunch of notion of genericity, and the last one is the optimal one is outside the exceptional set. So you can define an exceptional set. The exceptional set is exactly the set of points whose total inverse image is finite. Okay? It is an algebraic set, non-obvious theorem, And actually, this convergence holds exactly outside the exceptional set. So in that case, it was done by, let's say, Briand-Duval. And I should add the names of Dean and Ciboli. So again, you need to have more complicated techniques here to arrive at this optimal convergence. So yesterday I explained to you that when you have this equidistribution, then you get dynamical consequences of it. So here I have the same dynamical consequences. So theorem. So this is the Briand-Duval theorem. So as I said, so first statement, you have convergence outside a certain algebraic exceptional set. So this measure mu that you get is invariant. Invariant, it is mixing. The measure has positive Lyapunov exponents in all directions. So it is this measure is repelling. Let me state it like that. If for almost every x, for mu, almost every x, for every v in the tangent space at x, if you look at the action and the derivative on v, and you look at the norm in logarithmic scale, so dfnx applied to v, look at the norm, take log, take 1 over n, take lim inf, this is bigger than log d over 2. Bigger than or equal to log d over 2. So the measure is repelling in all directions. Okay, so you have two complex directions here. Third statement, this measure is the unique measure of maximal entropy. So again, if you know what it means, you're happy, otherwise you forget it. So that's statement about entropy. Is maximal. And fourth statement, this measure describes the distribution of repelling periodic orbits. So mu describes the distribution of periodic orbits, of repelling periodic orbits. So let me state something precise here. If you take 1 over d2n sum of Dirac masses at repelling points of period n, this converges to the measure mu. Now, you know that the total number of periodic points is about d to the power 2n2. So actually, the consequence of that is that most periodic points are repelling. So as I said yesterday, there are examples where I have infinitely many attracting points. But still, the total number is negligible with respect to d to the power 2n. Okay? Okay, so, yes? This is, I will spend the whole remaining of the lecture discussing the support of this measure. Okay? So the proof, just one word about the proof. The proof is the same as yesterday, basically. So the proof I presented yesterday I presented a proof which, in a sense, extends to two dimensions. One thing that you have to understand, this is the main thing in this theorem, is to understand what the Lubitsch lemma becomes in this case. So you don't have exactly the same Lubitsch lemma, so you have to prove one Lubitsch lemma along a certain line, and there's some work to be done. But as soon as you make sense of what the Lubitsch lemma is in this context, then you get the theorem for free, basically. Okay, so that's the Briand-Duval theorem. Okay, so I want to spend the rest of the lecture to the following question, so basic question. Is the support of the measure mu equal to the Julia set? And the answer is trivially no. I will give you an example in a moment. And so you see that you have two natural analogs for the Julia set in one dimension. One is the Julia set, in two dimensions, so the set of known normality, and the other analog is this circle. So this is not exactly the closure of periodic repelling orbits, but forget about it. Okay, so it may happen that you have a sporadic repelling orbits outside the support of the measure, but you forget about them. So this is another analog. This is another natural analog of the Julia set, of the one-dimensional Julia set. Okay, this is where the repelling dynamics takes place. Okay, so I would like to study. I would like to understand the interplay between these two guys. Okay, so let me perhaps first work out an example. So perhaps let me state a definition. So definition. So here it's a little stupid, but so it will be the Julia filtration. So here you have the filtration with two terms. So I will define J2, it's the support of the measure mu. J1 is the Julia set. And the Julia filtration is just J2 is contained in J1. Okay? It's clear that the support of the measure is contained in the Julia set because you have repelling dynamics here. So perhaps I should add P2 here. Okay? So in higher dimension, just a word about higher dimension. If you work in PK, then the green current is a codimension one object. So J is a codimension one object. So again, it is the support of a current of codimension one. And you have corresponding Julia sets corresponding to equidistribution of subvarieties of higher and higher codimension. So you have, for every Q, Q between 1 and K, you get a Julia set JQ, which is the support of the current which describes the distribution of codimension Q subvarieties. GQ is the support of, actually, the Qth power of the green current, which describes the distribution, of codimension Q in codimension Q. Pullbacks of codimension Q subvarieties. And then you have this filtration. So JK is the support of the maximal entropy measure, which is contained in JK minus 1, et cetera, up to J1, which is contained in PK. Okay? And the right analog of the Julia set in higher dimension is not only the Julia set, but the whole filtration here and the way each Julia set sits in the next one. Okay? So this is this is the last time I will talk about higher dimension. So let me try to explain you at least a picture of what is happening here. So the situation is in a sense analogous to the case of Kleinian groups, right? You have the small limit set, and the Kulkarni limit set. And so this one is a codimension one, so I don't know if it's the limit set of the, on the action of, I don't know what is the mirror in the dictionary, if it is the Kulkarni limit set or limit set of the action of lines. And you have the small limit set, which should be the closure of repelling points of Luxodromic elements. So you have the kind of dictionary between the two. So let me explain you the interplay between these two sets. So let's start with an example. We will work out a simple example. So let's start with an example. I will talk, so this study is due to Bedford and Johnson. So I will study polynomial maps on P2, on C2. Polynomial maps on C2 of the form PZW, QZW. And remember from yesterday that the term of higher degree, homogeneous term of higher degree, highest degree has something to say. And I will assume that it is of the form F is of the form ZD plus lower order terms, WD plus lower order terms. Okay, so the dominant term is ZDWD. So in that case, so let me draw my C2. So that's C2. And that's the line at infinity here. So we saw yesterday, so I made the computation. In such a case, this extends holomorphically to P2. So extends holomorphically without indeterminacy points to the line at infinity. Okay, and the induced dynamics on the line at infinity is given by this rational function. And F restricted to the... So the line at infinity, of course, is a P1. So you're looking for a rational map on P1. And it is just this rational map, ZD, WD in homogeneous coordinate, which is just the polynomial ZD. Okay, so this is a zeta goes to zeta to the D. So we know the Julia set at infinity. So the Julia set as infinity, so in the plane, the Julia set of the polynomial ZD, so that was my only example of Julia set. The Julia set of ZD is the unit circle. Okay, so for zeta goes to zeta D on C, the Julia set is the unit circle, and points inside the unit disk go to 0, and points outside go to infinity, right? So you have a certain unit circle here on the line at infinity, which is the Julia set at infinity. Now, you also can introduce the set K. It is the set of points with bounded orbits in C2. Okay, so if you look at the formula here, ZDWD, you see that if a point is as big norm, so that's a fact, if the norm of the point ZW is large, then the norm of if F of ZW is approximately norm of ZW to the D. Okay, so this term is dominating, and the other ones are negligible. So it's not always the case that for a polynomial map, when you take a large point, it goes far away. There can be some complicated cancellations, okay? But in this case, there's no cancellation. Okay, so it means that the line at infinity is an attracting set. So it means that the set of points with bounded orbits is compact in C2. So the set K is somewhere here. The set K is somewhere here. So K is compact. Bounded. Actually, it's closed. It's easy to prove that this is closed. So it's a compact set in C2. Okay, so now what if I look at preimages of points? So the basin, so it's not difficult to see that the basin of infinity is totally invariant. If you take a point which is attracted by infinity, every preimage is attracted by infinity. So if I take Z in the basin of infinity, the preimages of Z all these points belong to the basin of infinity, right? And they must converge to a set of points with bounded orbits. Because you take prime edges of points which are escaping to infinity. So this is this set as a set, this is converging to K. And since you come from the outside, this is converging to the boundary of K as a set. Actually, to a subset of the boundary of K, okay? So a consequence of that is the support of the maximal entropy measure is contained in the boundary of points with bounded orbits. So you see that the support of the measure is here, but there's another piece of the Julia set somewhere. So in that case, it is certainly different. It is not equal to the Julia set, which must contain the Julia set at infinity, right? Now there is more. Remember I said that the Julia set is always connected in P2. So there should be something connecting the Julia set at infinity to the boundary of K. Excuse me for that. So what is connecting? Let me do a little bit of hyperbolic dynamics where here. So, as I said, the Julia set at infinity is a certain circle contained in the line at infinity. Along the line at infinity, the picture is not here anymore, inside the line at infinity, the circle is repelling, right? Points in the circle go away from the circle. And actually, it is uniformly repelling, in a sense. So this is uniformly repelling inside the line at infinity. But now the line at infinity is an attractor for the dynamics. It's actually super attracting if you look at, if you do the change of coordinates, the transverse derivative is equal to zero. So the line at infinity itself is attracting. So it means that this Julia set as infinity is a hyperbolic subset, is a hyperbolic set, so you don't need to know what exactly what hyperbolic set mean for the dynamics. It's attracting on one side and repelling on the other side. Saddle set, exactly. It's a hyperbolic saddle set. So now when you have such a set, for every, so a consequence of that, for every x in this Julia set at infinity, I don't know why it is doing that. If you look at the set of points, y, such that the distance between the orbits iterates of x and y go to zero. Oh, sorry for that. I don't know what's... I promise I do nothing to to do this noise. If you look at this, the set of points which come close to the orbit of x, this is actually a piece of manifold. So this is, by definition, the stable manifold of x. And this is a manifold. At least locally, it's a manifold. So to every point... to every point on the Julia set at infinity is attached a piece, a local piece of stable manifold, okay? Which is a, it's a complex submanifold. Okay? And if you look at this stable manifold, let's say the local one, so you have the Julia set at infinity which is something like that. If you take a piece, so it's classical fact from hyperbolic dynamics, like if you take a little piece of disk here, the disk, this point here converges, at least it aligns with the orbit of x, but on the other side, it's exponentially expanding. So this is a, this substable manifold is contained in the Julia set. So it is contained in the Julia set. Okay, and the result by Bedford and Johnson is that you get the whole Julia set in the basin of infinity like that. Okay, so theorem. Theorem, the Julia set intersected with the basin of infinity is exactly the union of these stable manifolds for x in the Julia set at infinity. So you know exactly what the, exactly. You know what the, this Julia set looks like? It's a union of holomorphic submanifolds which connect infinity to the set K. And actually, there is more to that. There's a, so this family of, so on the picture, this family of blue submanifolds is actually a lamination. Okay, it's a lamination, and this lamination has a transverse measure. Okay, let me keep the picture here. This lamination has a transverse measure, which is given by, so you have a blue lamination by stable manifold, and it has a transverse measure, which is just the maximal equilibrium measure on this Julia set here at infinity, right? So you have a lamination with transverse measure, sorry for that, and actually it gives you the current. So you can form a current with that. You can integrate on the blue curves against this measure mu, and actually you get the green current like that. So the green current T, at least in the neighborhood of infinity, is the integral of current of integration on the local stable manifold. So the statement, it's a local statement near the line at infinity. When you pull back to K, you get some topological complications. But still, the local picture is always the same. So it's integral of current of integration against the measure on the Julia set, the natural measure on the Julia set at infinity. So you get the structure of the Julia set and the structure of the Green current. So the Green current is foliated, and on this foliated part, let me put perhaps a definition. So consequence, the Green current is foliated. Let me put forward a definition here. So what time is it? Okay. So definition. I say that a holomorphic disk in P2 is a Fatou disk if the dynamics along the delta is equicontinuous. If the sequence of iterates along delta is a normal family. Okay, so we see that in this example, the Julia set outside, so you have the support of the maximal entropy measure here, and the Julia set outside the support is foliated by Fatou disks. So in the previous example, if you look at the Julia set outside the basin of infinity, then you get this lamination by Fatou disks. Is laminated by Fatou disks. Because, of course, the dynamics along an unstable manifold converges exponentially, super exponentially fast to the line at infinity. So it's certainly contracting. Okay, so along the blue disk, it's contracting, and transversally, it's expanding. Okay. Right. So I stated the theorem for this special map here, but it's true for every theorem. The same result by Bedford and Johnson. You have basically the same result for every polynomial map on C2, which extends holomorphically at infinity, extending holomorphically. So there's a little difficulty here, which is that when you consider an arbitrary polynomial at infinity, the Julia set at infinity is not uniformly repelling anymore. Okay, uniform repulsion is by definition hyperbolicity. Okay, not every Julia set is uniformly expanding. It may happen that it's only non-uniformly expanding. So in that case, the picture is a little different. You don't have a foliation. So if it's not uniformly expanding, what you can show is that on the line at infinity, so you have the Julia set in pink. It's not exactly pink, but whatever. So this Julia set at infinity, something like that, carries a certain measure mu. Okay? So there's a dynamical systems theory for that. Non-uniform hyperbolicity tells you that you have a set of big measures, measured more than one half, where you have a nice foliation with disks of positive size. So you can fill out, there's a set of points of measure, say one half, where you can find disks like that of positive size. And then if you want to get more measure, you need to reduce the size of the disks. So perhaps, you will get more measure if you accept disks of a smaller size, and even more each time. If you want to get full measure, you must forget about the local triviality of the lamination. Okay, so you don't have a lamination with a locally bounded geometry. You get a lamination for every epsilon. You get a lamination in a neighborhood of a set of measure 1 minus epsilon. So it will. You can make a current with this. You can still integrate on this family of disks, but now you don't have a foliation in a measure theoretic sense. You get a foliation on a set of big measure, and so what you get is a so-called laminar current. So you get something which is foliated, but with no local uniform bound on the geometry. Okay? So what about the general case? What about the general case? So in the general case, so I take again any endomorphism of P2. I have my Julia set support of the maximal entropy measure and Julia set. Okay? Yes?
In this case, J2 is
support of the measure.
No, but in the previous.
It is concentrated on the boundary of K. It's the support of the measure by definition. It's not the whole boundary. It's the so-called Shilov boundary of K. It's a certain subset. So for instance, in this example, Z2W2, okay, the K is a polydisc, like that, and the support of the measure is the unit torus, not the whole boundary. Okay, so I want to investigate the geometry of J1 minus J. So let's say that on J2, we understand basically the dynamics. The dynamics is repelling. Okay, so dynamics is repelling here. Is exponentially repelling. Okay, and with the Lyapunov exponent larger than or equal to log D over 2. Okay? And now I would like to understand what happens on J1 minus J2. So you can imagine a model for the dynamics. So of course, here you have P2, and you could say that this one is J0, and J0 minus J1 is the Fatou set. So in the Fatou set, you have a quick continuity. And so what you should expect as a model for the dynamics is that on J1 minus J2, there should be one direction of equicontinuity and one direction of expansion. So there should be equicontinuity in one direction, continuity in one direction, and expansion outside, exactly as expansion outside. Exactly as in the case of a stable manifold of a saddle point or saddle set, you have contraction along the blue curve and expansion transverse to the blue curve. Okay? And you can even expect more. You could expect that J1 minus J2 is filled with Fatou disks in a sense. Filled with Fatou disks. So it will never be a lamination, right? Because we know that already for polynomial mappings on C2, you have these non-uniform examples where it's only filled with Fatou disks in some measure theoretic sense. Okay? But still, you can expect that you have plenty of Fatou disks, and the dynamics along this Fatou disk will give you this direction of equicontinuity. Okay, so first, I said several times that there's a measure theoretic sense. So what is the measure on J? So what is the ambient measure on J? So J is a fractal set, right? So you have the picture is something like that. You have J, this big set of codimension 1, and somewhere inside you have the measure mu. So mu is certainly not the ambient measure on J. Okay? On J, J is J1, yes. J1, and this is J2. Okay, so the ambient measure is not this very small one, right? So the ambient measure on J is given by the current. So J, remember that J is the support of a certain current. And as I said, a current is a differential form with measure coefficients. Okay, and this measure is exactly the ambient measure on the Julia set. So this ambient measure on J is called a trace measure. So this is a trace measure of the current T, which is the T wedge, the Keller form. So why is this a measure? T wedge, the Keller form. If you take a function, T wedge Keller form applied to a certain function phi, is just integral of is t applied to this form phi omega, right? So in the case of my foliated picture with the, you have the Julia set at infinity and the blue curves, I said that t is a foliation current associated to this foliation here. The ambient measure is just the associated current. So Lebesgue measure on the leaves times, in the, well, Riemannian measure on the leaves times the transverse measure, right? So that's what the trace measure is in this case. So it's really the ambient measure on the Julia set. Okay, so what you should expect is that there should be this in a measure theoretic sense. Okay? In measure theoretic sense. And the answer is that this is almost true. Let me erase this. So there are two theorems. So theorem one, which I proved a few years ago. So for almost every point in J1 minus J2, with respect to this measure sigma t, you get the picture you want. There exists a certain subspace in the tangent space, which I call the FATU subspace. So you have a measurable field of FATU subspaces such that if V belongs to this FATU subspace, then you have no exception. The Lim-sup of the 1 over n log of the norm of dfn x of V is non-positive. And if V does not belong to F, sorry for that. Let me just try something. Okay. If V does not belong to the FATU subspace, then the lim inf of this sequence, 1 over n log of the norm of the derivative, is larger than log d over 2. Okay, so you get the expected picture. So it's just a measurable field of subspaces. And so second natural question, can you integrate this field of subspaces to get FATU disk? And the answer is no. So theorem two, there are examples where you cannot, so on all examples that you can compute, you can integrate, right? But there are examples where it's not possible. So there exist examples. For which, so it's a little difficult to state precisely, but there is no family of holomorphic disks, of FATU disks, such that these FATU subspaces are the tangent spaces on disks. So let me say examples of polynomial maps for which this field of subspaces cannot be integrated, to a field of FATU disks. So how much time do I have? I have 2 minutes. So it's perhaps not reasonable to explain the proof in 2 minutes. Perhaps just one word in higher dimension. So what happens in higher dimension? So you get a pretty good understanding of what's happening, except that so there are certain sporadic examples where there are no FATU disks. I'm not moving. Don't move. And I don't know any criterion which ensures that you get this field of FATU, except one. So there are these examples of polynomial mappings, and there's a theorem by De Telin, which says that if F is post-critically finite, meaning that the orbit of the critical set is algebraic, then one can FATU disks exist. So you can integrate. So the current T is a laminar current. So you can integrate this field of fat to disk, this field of directions to a field of disks. But I don't know any other criterion. Okay? And what about higher dimension? So in higher dimension, there's a conjectural picture, which is not a theorem. So you get this filtration of Julia sets. So this JQ here is the support of the current TQ, so the set where preimages of Q co-dimensional subsets accumulate. And so now it's just a conjecture. It's just a conjecture that on JQ minus JQ plus 1 for every Q, then there exists a Fatou subspace of codimension Q, subspace of codimension Q, and remaining directions are repelling with the same rate log d over 2. Remaining directions are repelling. Okay, so that's a theorem for Q equals 1. So same as this one, actually. So that's a theorem for Q equals 1, but just a conjecture for the other cases. Okay?
All dimensions.
Because working with currents of by degree 1-1 is simpler because they come from, so they're the DDC of something. So it's always simpler to work with co-dimension 1 currents. Okay? And so the proof is just positive currents techniques. Okay, and I think I will stop here, and since I'm the last talk of this session, I would like to, all of us, to thank the organizers for this first beautiful week of lectures. Thank you.